Welcome everyone to Wednesday Night at Bayside. As you know, we are doing online this week just as a precaution for an outbreak with the Easley family. We want to pray for them that God would touch Sister Whitney, who is not feeling well, and also the kids who also tested positive today. So we want to keep them in our prayers. We've had no other reports of positive testing, so we're thankful for that. But this message you're about to hear from Brother Josh Herring is our heartbeat right now here at Bayside. It's all about the gospel message. It's all about making disciples. It's all about being sure in the truth, with the foundation truths of God's word. And so as you get ready to listen to this, I pray that you are blessed. I pray that you're filled. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, if you need a renewing of the Holy Ghost, I pray you have a renewing tonight. But let God do what he wants to do in you. Amen. So listen intently. Be in this message tonight, and you're going to be blessed. All right. We'll see you on Sunday. We're looking forward to a wonderful Mother's Day service this coming Sunday. Sister Size will be speaking. God bless you.
Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled. Somebody say they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Verse 16 through 18. This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. Shall come to pass in the last days. Somebody say, in the last days. Saith God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. 37 to 39. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Amen. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. I want to preach to you for a few minutes this morning. The last days are here. The last days are here. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, you're going to get the Holy Ghost today. And turn to the other neighbor and tell them, you really need the Holy Ghost today. Some of you married folk are like, amen, that's God talking right. Are you ready for God to do what only God can do? Let's clap our hands in faith and thank the Lord one more time. Something about to happen. Hallelujah. I love you, Jesus. And you may be seated. The Bible says, Jesus said that in the last days, there would be all kind of terrible things that would happen. There would be wars, and there would be rumors of wars. Nation would rise up against nation. In the Greek, that is ethnos versus ethnos, or ethnicity would rise up against ethnicity. There would be racism in the last days. The Bible said in the last days that kingdom would rise up against kingdom. That's country against country. The Bible says in the last days there would be earthquakes, and there would be pestilences, and there would be famines, and everything that I just mentioned is happening across the world at a rapid pace. pace. You do not even need to leave this country to find some of the things that I just mentioned. It's happening all over the world. Truly, we are in the last days, and you may not believe now, but I promise you one day the sky will split open and every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord. He is about to come back. Feel it or don't feel it, he's about to come back. You might not believe in him today, but your knee will bow. You might be a Satan worshiper, but your knee will bow. You might be an atheist, but your knee will bow. You might be a Muslim, but your knee will bow. There's only one king, and he's coming back. He's coming for you, and he's coming for me. Somebody shout the name of that king. Hallelujah. And the Bible also declares that in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. We are in a time like never before where the Spirit of God is being poured out across the world at a pace it never has been in the history of mankind. In just my little life, I can tell you, in my little world, preaching this gospel 17 years across this nation, the first 12 years or so, we saw a couple thousand people get the Holy Ghost. But in the last 5 years, we've seen over 10,000 people get the Holy Ghost. That's not about us. It's about the fact that we are in the last days, and Jesus, Shota, is about to come back. And I feel him in this room right now. If you're not ready, you need to get ready before you leave this building. The most important thing you'll ever do is make sure you're going to heaven. Amen. UN representative told us in May of 2017 that in 1994, a man walked into the United Nations with a proposal of a one world government, trying to get all the nations of the world to agree behind the scenes and get their banks to connect. And he said in May of 2017 that all the banks and the connections have happened across the world in the governments except for three nations. Three nations have defied the one world government. Those three nations are North Korea and Iran and Cuba. And he said that those three nations will be in the news more than other nations, because truly behind the scene, there's pressure on them to break and bow down to the one world government, where you have to have the mark of the beast, as the Bible calls it, to purchase anything. Now is not a time to have your head in the sand. Now is not a time to live in fear. It's a time to get ready to meet Jesus. We are truly living in the last days. You're not here by accident this morning. God brought you here. He intends to fill you with his Spirit. He wants to wash away your sin. He wants you to live in heaven with him forever. And in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. God is pouring out the Holy Ghost like never before. Can I tell you, the Holy Ghost is the greatest miracle that you'll ever receive. I know we go crazy over a physical healing, and we should, but the Holy Ghost is a greater miracle than a physical healing. You can be healed of cancer and be blind and God open your eyes and get out of a wheelchair, and that's powerful. But if you go to hell, it doesn't matter. But if God washes away your sins and fills you with his Spirit, that's an access code to a place that you want to get to, that everyone needs to be at. It's the greatest miracle you'll ever experience, ever. And the Holy Ghost is for everyone. I don't care what background you have. I don't care what belief system you're in, what you were brought up believing. The Holy Ghost is for you. He said it's a promise unto you and your children and to all that are afar off. He was talking about us right there. He wants to live inside of you. When you receive the Holy Ghost, God steps out of heaven and pours himself into you. And now the creator of the universe
is living, Shataya, inside of you. And greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Hallelujah. There is nothing like receiving the Holy Ghost. Drink any drink that you want to drink. Try any alcoholic beverage that you want. It will not fill you and fulfill you like the Holy Ghost will. You'll want more. You'll have a headache. You'll have a hangover. But Jesus said, he that drinketh of the water I shall give him shall never thirst again. You can try any drug you want to try, but there's still no high like the Most High God of Israel. Can I get a witness up in here of anybody that's tried alcohol or drugs, but when you tried Jesus, you knew there's nothing like the power of God living inside of me. Somebody clap your hands and shout hallelujah. It's for everyone. It's for everyone. I don't care how bad your background is. I was in Modesto a few months ago when they on Sunday morning, I said, we're in the last days. Don't be surprised if the worst of the worst show up to church just so God can prove a point to you how great he is. And I said, don't be shocked if Satan worshipers show up. That's how powerful God is. He can save anyone. That was Sunday morning. Sunday night, a well-known satanic worshiper walked in the back door of that church. She was well-known in the city. They said, we cannot believe it. A Satan worshiper in the city is here tonight, and she's well known, and she was doing her crazy stuff. But by the time the altar call came, she walked down to the front, didn't know what to do, but raised her hands, and God filled her with the Holy Ghost. We baptized her in the name of Jesus, and God washed away her sins. She came in worshiping the devil, but she left worshiping the King of Glory. Hallelujah. Just a year and a half ago, in one of the caves in Pakistan, three Taliban soldiers walked into a service where Pastor Art Wilson was preaching, and they sent me the picture. Three soldiers, two soldiers, and one son of a soldier, a teenager, walked in to intimidate the people. But before the service was over, those three men came to the front and raised their hands, and God filled all three of them with the gift of the Holy Ghost, because it's a promise in the last day, Shotaya, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Amen. Amen. Well, how do I get the Holy Ghost? What do I do? How does it work? I've got so many questions. Well, let's go to the Bible. Acts chapter 2. Let's go back. John chapter 3. Let's start there. John chapter 3 and verse number 5. Let's start there so you can see this for yourself. Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, capital S, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Didn't say you can't preach on TV. Didn't say you can't be famous. Didn't say you can't go to church. It says you can't be in the kingdom. So, I mean, when it comes down to the end, you'll be lost is what it's saying. All right, Romans chapter 8 and verse number 9. Romans 8, verse number 9. Let's go to that verse. Paul said, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, capital S. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. You can accept him all day as your personal Savior. That does not mean he's accepted you. That's so cute how we put God in our box. Well, I've accepted him like we're God. That is not how it works in the kingdom of God. In fact, you won't find your Bible anywhere where you accept the Lord as your personal Savior and be saved. That's a man-made doctrine or a demonic-made doctrine. But the Bible said you must be born of the water and the Spirit to enter the kingdom of God. Well, how do I get the Holy Ghost? Let's go back to the Bible, Acts chapter 2. And verse number 4, we're having a little Bible study today. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost, we read it earlier, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Acts chapter 10, verse 45 and verse 46. And they of the circumcision, which believed, were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles, that's you and I, was also poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. Verse number 46, how'd they know? For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Acts chapter 19, verse number 5. If I was the devil, I'd leave Vida right now. Acts 19, verse 5 and 6. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And verse 6 said, when Paul laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. When you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, the evidence that you have it, it comes out of your mouth in a different tongue. Jesus said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Spirit. Well, if you believe that you received the Holy Ghost but did not speak in tongues, might as well call it out. What you're actually saying is that the Spirit of God poured itself into you and your human spirit kept it down. And therefore, your human spirit is stronger than God's Holy Spirit. But that is contradictory to the Word of God, because the verse I just read said, he said it will come out of your belly like rivers of living water. In other words, that's the signal to you that God is letting you know that he is living in you, because you cannot keep God down on the inside. He is a consuming fire, and he must control whatever he pours himself into. Make sense? The evidence, the speaking in tongues, is the evidence for you that God has filled you with his Spirit. Whether it's 2 words, 2,000 words, 2 minutes, or 20 minutes, or 2 hours, if it comes out, that's God letting you know he's poured himself into you. And the more you pray and the more you live for God, the more you get. And I wouldn't want to live a day in my life without speaking in tongues, because it's the evidence that God is living in me. Every day that you go by and you do not worship God and you do not break out and magnify, that's you're wondering, is he in me? But if you can worship God until you're speaking in tongues and magnify him, I know you don't get it every day, but you can if you pray hard and you believe and you have faith. He can fill you again and again and again. And it doesn't matter how long you've prayed for it. I remember I was preaching this revival in Arkansas. I'll say the state. I won't say the city. And the building, I was first couple years evangelized. It was two sections of pews, and it went back like 4 miles. Seated like 650 people, and they had 30 people in the church. And they all sat on the back 2 rows. True story. And there was one cordless mic, Bishop, and I wasn't allowed to use it because it was pastor's mic. I got the yellow corded mic with the big clown head thing, and it stretched like 4 feet. And I said, can I use your mic? Because everybody in your church is in the very back of the building. He said, they can hear you. Yeah, I'm like, but they can't see me. He's like, you're fine. So I preached Sunday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and the following Sunday. On Sunday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, no one moved. I mean, they were trained well. It was like a cemetery. I probably had a greater move of God in a cemetery. And it was, nothing was happening. The evangelist quarters was nasty. There was cockroaches everywhere. It was a great place. All kind of memories are flooding my mind right now. And so I remember on Friday night, after church ended, I thought, man, God must be sending me here to punish me for something. And so Saturday, I said, I got 1 day left. So I went to the church Saturday night about 11 o'clock, and I walk in the sanctuary. It's pitch black in the sanctuary. And I'm walking around. I'm praying back and forth for like an hour. God, please let somebody come to the altar tomorrow. Let somebody move. Let somebody breathe. Let somebody burp. Let somebody do something. Let there be life in this place. I'm speaking life. Let someone show a sign that they even want you. And I turn, and there's a man right here. Not right there, right here. About 75 years old. And I'm thinking, angel or devil, but either way, we're about to fight. Jacob, part two is about to happen. And I said, can I help you? He said, yeah, I heard you praying. I said, you heard me praying? You were in here? He said, yeah, I was asleep under the pew. I was like, do you live here? He said, no. I said, what are you sleeping under the pew for? He said, well, you probably wouldn't. You wouldn't imagine. He said, but I'm 75, and I've gone to this church for 52 years, and I've not received the Holy Ghost. And every Saturday night, I come to the church to pray to try to get it. And I prayed, and I didn't get it, and I fell asleep. And I just didn't want to bother you. I'm like, oh, you bothered me. And you're getting the Holy Ghost before you leave here, period. Like, I don't care what else happens, but you're getting the Holy Ghost. We will stay here all night. He said, well, I don't. You understand, son. I've prayed. 50. I said, I don't care how long you've prayed. No offense. I said, but you need some faith. God's going to give you the Holy Ghost right now. And the devil will get in your head and consume you with doubt, and you're trying to control it, trying to analyze it. You can't be like that with God. When it comes to the Holy Ghost, you've got to let it out and worship the Lord and not care what it sounds like. Not control God. Tears started rolling down his eyes. His name was Alan. Alan raised his hands. I laid hands on him. And in 30 seconds, God filled Alan with the gift of the Holy Ghost, because it's a promise. It's a promise. It's a promise. Hallelujah. We were in a revival in Stockton, California, and this lady came up during the revival and after church. She said, I wanted to come see how real it was in person. I said, what do you mean? She said, I just got released from prison last Saturday. And she said, I was in prison for a while. And she said, during this revival, apparently, someone from your church came in and brought a message of you preaching about the Holy Ghost right before I was released. And she said, the guards let me and my cellmate listen to this message about the Holy Ghost. And she said, you were preaching about people receiving, how it was for everyone, no matter what they had done, no matter how bad it was for everyone. It was a promise. And she said, at the end, you told people to come forward. And she said, you repented with them. And when you repented, we repented in our jail cell. We didn't know what we were doing. And she said, at the end, you had everyone raise their hands and you told them to shout hallelujah when you prayed. And she said, we looked at each other in our jail cell, Bishop. And she said, we just raised our hands. And when you said shout hallelujah, hallelujah, we both shouted hallelujah. And said, the next thing you know, me and my cellmate were both filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost in the prison cell. Well, I feel faith in here right now. I went to a men's conference a year or two later in Florida, and I told that story right in the middle of the message. God told me to tell that story about that lady in a men's conference, and I didn't know our idea, but there was a man out there that had a prison ministry. He took the CD of that message, went to the prison in Tampa, and had 17 prisoners there. He just pushed play at the end when I said, come forward. Those prisoners walked to the front of the room, and they repented. I told them, in the message, raise your hands. When they raised their hands and they shouted hallelujah, God filled all 17 of them with the gift of the Holy Ghost. The man came back 1 year later and he said, you're not going to believe it. We have 18 new converts, and I brought them in last night and I played the message again, and all 18 this time walked to the front, raised their hands, and God filled every single one of them with the gift of the Holy Ghost, because it's a promise. Stand to your feet, clap your hands, and worship your God. There's nothing as powerful as the gift of the Holy Ghost coming upon you. Well, how do I get it? I don't even know how to stay standing. You can stay. I'm done. I don't even know how to pray. What do I do? I'll tell you how to get it. I can't give it to you. Bishop and all his wisdom, he can't give it to you. But we have a God that will give it to you. All right? Here's how you get the Holy Ghost. Number one, you repent of your sins. You can't get the Holy Ghost if you don't repent of your sins. If you're not going to turn away and sorry for what you've done and turn away from sin. God's not interested in being your roommate. Where God fills this part of you and God gets you on Sunday morning, but the world and hell gets you. You're going to make mistakes. We all do. If you've ever sinned, raise your hand. And I'm going to close my eyes because I'm sure someone didn't raise their hand. And they just committed their first sin, lying in church. Okay? We all have to repent. So before in a few moments, before we pray for the Holy Ghost, we'll all repent of our sins. Everybody. In fact, I'm going to ask Bishop, you'll lead us in the prayer of repentance. Just, we're all going to repent together. We'll follow Bishop, and we'll just do whatever he says. We'll repent of our sins, okay? Number two, you have to desire the Holy Ghost to receive it. If you do not want the Holy Ghost, and everybody on your pew wants it, God will jump right over you and fill everybody else. He loves you, but he's not going to force you. But now, just buckle up with this part. Don't call yourself a Christian, a Christ follower, if you don't want Christ living in you. Don't lie about him. Oh, yeah. Don't say, well, I love him, but I don't want him in me. Because that's a pretty shallow love right there. Number three, you have to focus your mind on the Lord. Not on the preacher, not on where you're going to eat, not on who's praying with you, not on who you're standing by, who brought you to church. Your mind has to be on God. Now, I don't know what you would think of on the cross or coming back in the sky. I don't know, but you have to get your mind on how great he is. Not how bad you are. Why you say that? Because I do this every week. I see people try to get the Holy Ghost, and some people pray things like this. I don't deserve it. I'm not worthy. Please give it to me. I'm a terrible person. I'm not worthy. You're not. Your mind's not on God. Your mind's on you. Let's call it that. What? That's pride. You're saying you can't feel me because I'm so terrible. Well, that's good preaching, whether you didn't shout it or not. So your mind's not on how good or bad you are. It's not about how good or bad you are. It's about how great he is. So your mind's on him. Number four, you have to have faith that you're going to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost today. What is faith? Faith is this. Faith is, I'm not leaving here without it. That's faith. Faith is not, well, I hope I'll go up there and let's see what happens. That's not faith. That's hope. But faith is, I would be shocked if God does not pour out his spirit upon me today. That's faith. And the big one, number five, everybody from front to back. Here's the big one. Ready? You have to worship God with your own mouth. You can't expect to get the Holy Ghost if you keep your mouth shut. You're not going to speak in tongues if you refuse to speak. I remember Pastor Daryl Johns in Atlanta, Georgia, on a Saturday outreach service when a man walked up and they said, that's our new convert. That's Kevin. He's 34 years old. I said, awesome. I walked up to him. Kevin had no tongue. They said, you're not going to believe it, but last Saturday in front of 200 people, even though Kevin was born without a tongue. Oh, I've got your attention now. He raised his hands, never spoke a word in his life, but when he raised his hands and opened his mouth, words came out in a different language, and he didn't understand it, but God said, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Ask your neighbor, do you have a tongue? Somebody didn't want to ask that, like six people asked it. Then you can get the Holy Ghost. There's nothing in your way. Nothing. Nothing can stop you from getting the Holy Ghost. If you had it 25 years ago and you haven't prayed through since, you need to get the Holy Ghost today. You've been in every bar, every club. You've been smoking everything. And since you need the Holy Ghost again today. You got drunk last night. You need to get the Holy Ghost today. Someone's in here, they got drunk last night. You need to get the Holy Ghost today in this building. God wants to fill you with the gift of the Holy Ghost today. And then you tell me later, what's more powerful, the alcohol or the Holy Ghost? I already know the answer. Here's what we're going to do in a moment. In a moment, we're all going to come to the front together, everyone together. Because I don't like it whenever some people do it differently. I like it when we're all together as a family. One mind, one accord is when the Holy Ghost fell in the book of Acts. And we're going to repent of our sins. And when Bishop leads you, you do exactly what he says. But don't just listen to him repent. You pray with your mouth. You speak it. Lord, forgive me. I'm sorry for what I've done wrong. You can't bypass repentance and get the miracle. And you repent of your sins. Now watch this. And when we pray the prayer of faith, which is basically me taking my faith and connecting it with your faith, at the end I'll have you shout hallelujah. And you know why we shout hallelujah? Because that's the highest praise you can give God. And when you worship God, if you don't know how to worship God, just start telling him hallelujah. I love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. What you're telling him is, I give you everything. It's the best I can give you. And the Bible says he dwells in the praises of Israel or his people. In other words, when you start to praise him the best that you can, he comes out of heaven and starts to dwell among you. And God is a spirit, and his spirit will come upon you. And guess what? Some of you will say hallelujah one time. That'll be the last thing you say in English. It'll come out of your mouth in a different language. You might speak Spanish. It will come out of your mouth in a different language. It will not be your native tongue. It might even sound like gibberish, but you just let it flow out. And I promise you this, I've been waiting to say this all day. When you get the Holy Ghost, you've never had more joy. You've never had more peace. You've never had more power. You've never had more authority. You've never had more faith. Your life's about to change today. When you get the gift of the Holy Ghost, you will never be the same again. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Oh, peace of God, reign on me. My spirit's calling to be free. My heart is heavy, I'm weighted down, for I know that your presence will always be around. Oh, peace of God, reign on me. My spirit's calling to be free. My heart is heavy, for I know that your presence will always be around. Oh, peace of God, reign on me. My spirit's calling to be free. My heart is heavy, I'm weighted down, for I know that your presence will always be around. Ooh. this is all. Understanding. For the peace of God surpasses all understanding. For the peace God surpasses all understanding. Ooh, for the peace of God, it surpasses all understanding. Oh, peace of God. My spirit's calling to be free. Oh, my heart is heavy. I'm weighted down, for I know that your presence will always be around. For I know that your presence will always be around. For I know that your presence will always be around. Ooh. Hey, for the peace of God surpasses all understanding. For the peace of God will surpass all. I know that it will. Ooh. I know that it will.